Good morning.
Good morning.
And a very warm welcome to our homecoming service. Please sign the friendship register and include your name, address, phone, or email so that evangelism can drop off a goodie bag and some homemade baked goods. One of my very favorite events is taking place this afternoon, the annual ice cream social at 4 p.m. under the tent in the church parking lot. If you have not been asked to bring a dessert or ice cream, please just come and enjoy. I think I say this every time I'm up here, but our church has the most wonderful cooks and bakers. And of course, there's homemade ice cream. It doesn't get much better than that. Drinks and table service will be provided. Ellen Tingley asked me to give you some information about a train trip to Chicago. Plans are being made to go on Wednesday, September 23rd. That's Wednesday, September 23rd. Plans are still in the works. We've talked about the possibility of shopping, visiting Grant Park, the Skywalk, the Bean, the Art Institute, not all in one day, the Museum of Science and Industry, an architectural tour, or seeing the musical Million Dollar Quartet. So if this sounds interesting, please come to a planning meeting this next Sunday, August 30th, at 10 a.m. in the sitting room off the parlor. And if you're pretty sure that you're going to be able to make the trip, you might want to go ahead over to the train station and purchase your ticket. Right now, the tickets are $44 round trip, but it goes up considerably later on. All church women are invited, but not the men. Sorry, guys. are there any other announcements? I know Bill Froom would like to introduce somebody special this morning.
Well, good morning. We have a special treat this morning. For Homecoming Sunday, we actually brought somebody back from the church. Linda Andrews is with us. You probably know her as Linda Blivens, little Linda Blivens. You know, she's the one that all the boys really were afraid to date because of her father. For those of you that don't know the backstory, her father was a longtime sheriff of the county. And they knew they would have to meet him sometime, right? We have a couple of different things to tell you about this morning. The first hymn has an interlude where we're going to actually change keys. Woo! And after the fourth verse, you'll probably not want to sing right away, but I think you'll know when to come back in. Just know that after the fourth verse, we want to pause a bit. Then at the end of the service, we're going to ask you to sit down after the benediction and listen to the postlude. This is a piece by Paul Mance, one of my absolutely favorite organ pieces ever, and I think you'll see why at the end of the service. We're glad that the Presbyterian Church had a picnic service this morning outside where they didn't need the organ, and glad that Linda could be with us instead.
Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the prelude.
Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. You can clap if you want. That was nice. Please stand, if able, for the call to worship. Come one and all to honor the Christ who gives of his whole self so that we might live. Prepare yourselves to feed on the Holy One.
For he will sustain and strengthen us for the ministry ahead.
Praise be to God. Amen. The opening hymn is Praise to the Lord the Almighty, page 25. God, we give you thanksgiving for this opportunity to come together and worship you. We delight in your spirit that reunites community. Be with us that we may feel the power in this place and know that you are here ready to change our lives. Amen. Would the children please come forward for the children's moment?
Yes. Good morning, everyone. How are you today? Good. Wow, we have a whole army up here of men and boys. We are going to talk about a word today that many adults have occasion to think about often, and that word is faith. So the first question I want to ask you is, what are some things that we can't see, but we know they're there? Yep. Heaven, can't see it, but you know it's there. What else? Yeah. God, you guys are so far ahead of where I was thinking. Say it again. Love, that's a good one. How about the stuff that's all around us right now? What is that? Air, can't see it, but we know it's there. Wind is kind of the same way, isn't it? And then there's another one that we talked about at Bible school, starts with a G. Gravity, very good, Aaron, gravity. We know it's there. What if it wasn't? We'd be floating around like if we were up in space, right? So all of those are things that we can't see, but we know that they're there. Now that you gave me all those nice answers like God in heaven, how do you know those things are there? What do you look at? The Bible. There's a lot of information in the Bible that helps us to know that those are things are there, even though we are not able to see them. That is right. Let's see. Last question I want to ask you is there anywhere else that you can look to help you to build your faith? Let's think about people we trust. What do you think?
Brother.
Your brother. Okay. What do you think? Can you think of one? Okay. You want me to come back? Okay. Who are people that we look up to? Aunts and uncles, and I heard parents over here. Yes. So all of those, and I can think of somebody that's sitting behind you that you might be able to talk to, too. Who's that? Kelly. Thank you. For me, and I'm going to let you in on a secret, faith is a hard thing. And guess what? Adults don't totally get it either. It's a hard concept. And so we have to work at it all the time. And as an adult, I have a couple people that I look up to, too. One is my dad, because my dad has had a lot of health problems over the last 20 years of his life. But you know what? I'll be scared and worried, and he'll be at peace, because he has that faith and he trusts that God will watch out for him and do what is best for him. And I can think of another person too in the congregation who I look up to, and that's Mary Stepanovich. So you, in your life, you want to always look for those people who have that great faith, and you're already on the road because you gave me all those great answers of God in heaven. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us to remember that no matter what our obstacles may be, our faith in you will bring us peace and unlock your power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It is great to see everybody today. I think you can look up to Norma too, by the way. I think if they hadn't been pointing at me, they would have seen you first. I want to say welcome to everybody to our homecoming Sunday. I know that that's already been said, but you can't say it enough on a great day like this. It's so good to see so many folks. We've mentioned Linda coming back, and Linda, what a great gift you have. We are so blessed by your music today, but we're going to be blessed by someone else whom we haven't seen in quite a while, and Jim West is back with us. And Jim and Peggy, we're glad to have you back from Peoria. We'll take you anytime we can get you, and we miss you dearly. And so, Jim, thanks for coming to use your gift of music today during our homecoming Sunday. We welcome back some students. I see Cole over here. I haven't seen Cole in a while, so welcome back, Cole, and all students. We are excited to have you back in town. Ann and I live a couple of blocks from university, and the traffic in our area of town has picked up about 3,000%. It is busy, and we love it, and it's been great. I would share with you that yesterday we took the largest group of folks to a regional event called New Day, a day to pray and play with imagination. So I'm going to ask those folks who attended New Day to stand up, please. If you were on the van yesterday, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, yep, that's it, that's all 11 of us. Stay standing. These great people represented us. We went to learn, we went to try to think, we tried to vision, and there's another event on October the 3rd, right? October the 3rd, and every one of these people have been encouraged to take one of you with them to the next event. So don't be surprised if you, we were told, actually, this is what, because we were the largest group, they said to every other church but Macomb, bring as many people as you can. You Macomb folks, you're limited to one more person besides yourself. So my thanks to all of you for taking a Saturday away to go and be at a regional event like that, and ask them what they experienced and get to know what that was like, and thank them for me for taking the time to do that. I would share with you some of the prayer concerns that we have for our Sunday morning, and these flowers are a gift from the memorial service for Carolee Smith, and that was a really good morning. Jack McKinnon is off teaching children's church, but he was asked to speak because he and Carolee taught in the same classroom for 14 years together. And those of you who were at the Third Thursday, you men who were at Third Thursday, we're getting some clear delineations about who can come to what and go where. And so, he said that Carolee was one of his heroes. That's what we talked about on Thursday night, were heroes. And so, we pray for Don and the rest of the family as they struggle, as anybody does when it comes time to lose someone close. And so we'll keep them in our prayers. This morning I was made aware that Doris Allen's daughter, Kay Henderson, passed away. Arrangements are still pending, and we'll make sure that you know that electronically. But please keep Doris and her family, her grandchildren especially, in your prayers this morning. We celebrate that Patty Jones's mom's surgery, which was happening while we were in church last Sunday, turned out great. And so she is back home, and home is at Wesley. And so we keep your mom in our prayers and you in our prayers as she continues her rehabilitation. We also are thankful that Tweed Mummer is back in Macomb. He, you know, was off and in a hospital and dealing with lots of stuff, and now he's back. He is also in the rehab unit at Wesley and is just looking to get stronger so that he can return home, and I know that several folks have gone to see him over the course of the last week, which is great. So let's keep Tweed and Darlis in our prayers too. People who have been in our prayers for some time: Amy Connors, Joanne Horner, Brad Becker, Kent Woodford, Sue Boyer, Teresa Munir, and Amy Harmon. We do have news that Carol is back from Korea, and so we will see her back in worship next week, and we're glad that she's traveled safely to and from and was able to be a mom like a mom would want to be, to go and be with their daughter who is in need. So as we come into this moment of prayer time, let's just breathe a little. Let's center ourselves on our God, and let us realize that God is definitely in this place in this moment. May we listen as much as we speak a prayer this morning. As we begin our prayer, let's begin in silence. Gracious, loving parent of us all. We come to you this morning as your children, grateful for the many ways in which we can recognize you. We pray that there are times that are difficult for us. For all those folks that we have mentioned this morning, we ask for your help and your care, your concern and your friendship. We pray for our community as all students are starting back. We pray for our younger students that this school year can be an opportunity filled with wonder and learning and friendship. We pray the same for our college students who are coming back to town. May this be a year of good preparation, an opportunity to see a bigger world and to begin to think of what might come next. We pray, God, today that we will understand a little more about your faith, how it can impact our lives, how it can change us for the better. We come to know this faith through your Son, the one we call the Christ, this Jesus for whom we are disciples. We pray, God, that we will see something in him like his disciples and Paul. We pray that we can live our lives like his disciples and like Paul, committing to the faith so that others can come to know of you. Help us to be humble servants, God. Help us to want to be your people. Keep us filled up today so that keeping the faith will be easy. Give us your strength and your courage and your determination to be your faithful people. And when we fail, when we're less than successful, when we have a misstep, surround us with your love and grace. Remind us that we're still loved, that we're never thrown away, cast out, but because of your faith, because of your grace, because of your love and forgiveness and hope. That you always gather us back in. You always welcome us with open arms. You always call us home. Thank you for being a God of homecoming. Thank you for being a God in all moments, good or bad. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. We pray this prayer in the name of your Son. We pray the words that he taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before I start, I just want to say thanks, Kelly, for the kind words to welcome us back. Peggy and I are really glad to be here. And you might be wondering why I'm singing How to Say Goodbye on Homecoming Sunday. But there's two reasons for that. One is the words of the song, I think, tie in with Paul's scripture for today, where he's getting to nearing the end of his journey and sending his followers on their way. And also, I'm sure even though we are welcoming everybody, you know, college students back, Peggy and I aren't alone in seeing some of our own kids go their own way as well. So that's what the song's about. Tell me when the time we had slipped away, tomorrow turned to yesterday, and I don't know how. Tell me what can stop this river of tears. It's been building up for years for this moment now. Here I stand, arms open wide. I've held you close, kept you safe till you could fly. Tell me where the road ahead is gonna bend, and how to harness up the wind, and how to say goodbye. Tell me why does following your dreams take you far away from me? And I knew that it would. Tell me how to fill the space you left behind, and how to laugh instead of cry, and how to say goodbye. Here I stand, arms open wide. I've held you close, kept you safe till you could fly. Tell me where the road ahead is gonna bend, and how to harness up the wind, and how to say goodbye.
I was told that Peggy had to sit somewhere where Jim couldn't see her today because they just both burst out into tears if they saw each other. So, did you hide well enough, Peggy? Okay. Jim, that was great. Thank you so very much. And you're right, the themes do match very well. We do come to our fourth sermon in this series on 2 Timothy, and today we entitle the sermon Faith Keepers. We remember that in the first chapter of this book that Paul calls on the church to be the church, we're reminded that this is part of a pastoral letter series. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus are the pastoral letters reminding the church, especially near the end of Paul's life, reminding the church to stay true to its calling, reminding Timothy to stay true to his calling, to be bold, to live up to that high calling, to preach the gospel no matter where it might end you up or end him up. Paul was writing from prison, and he was okay with that. He was not ashamed. The second and third chapters reminded us that we are to focus our ministry on Christ, that the only if statements we need in our ministry are if we believe in Christ, if we follow in the ways of Jesus. These are the things that we are reminded. If we do that, if we follow in Jesus' footsteps, if Christ is our model, then we will become role models for others, that people will be able to come to know the faith through us. And so today, we think about keeping that faith, how to really be that role model. So we come to our fourth in what's been, I think, a good and interesting series, a reminder of how important Paul has been to the establishment of the church and how important Paul can be into the establishment of us as keepers of the faith. So as we come, let us hear the word from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. May God add blessing and understanding to the hearing of this word this day. As we get started with our sermon today, I thought we might watch a little video to get us started. Let's pay attention to that for a minute.
After being cut from his high school basketball team, he went home, locked himself in his room, and cried. He wasn't able to speak until he was almost 4 years old, and his teachers said he would never amount to much. Was demoted from her job as a news anchor because she wasn't fit for television. Fired from a newspaper for lacking imagination and having no original ideas. At age 11, he was cut from his team after being diagnosed with a growth hormone deficiency, which made him smaller in stature than most kids his age. At 30 years old, he was left devastated and depressed after being unceremoniously removed from the company he started. A high school dropout whose personal struggles with drugs and poverty culminated in an unsuccessful suicide attempt. A teacher told him he was too stupid to learn anything and that he should go into a field where he might succeed by virtue of his pleasant personality. Rejected by Decca Recording Studios, who said, "We don't like their sound, they have no future in show business." His first book was rejected by 27 publishers. His fiancée died, failed in business, had a nervous breakdown, and was defeated in 8 elections. If you've never failed, you've never tried anything new.
Did you know some of that? Could you look at the description and know some of them? Who knew that Thomas Edison had a pleasant personality? And I think I'm going to preach the rest of my sermon in that voice. We'll need Jeff for that. He's probably better at those things than I am. Just think about this world. If Michael Jordan had gone home from that basketball practice where he was cut from his team, what tennis shoes would we wear? Can you imagine a world without Dr. Seuss? Can you? What would you read to your child? I mean, what graduation gift would you give to your children when they're seniors in high school and college? Oh, the places you'll go. Oprah Winfrey, she has her own TV network now. These folks maybe had to try a little harder. These folks maybe had to persist through some critical judgment about who they were. But look at the great work that they have done. Abraham Lincoln, one of our own state's sons, what an impact he had in the world, and he never gave up. He had to keep believing. He had to keep believing, at least in himself. Now, we don't know necessarily the religious perspective of any of these folks up here without doing a little digging, but there's something about believing, about keeping on, about fighting those good fights and running those good races, and keeping the faith. If we, as Christians, can do what these folks, who may or may not have belief, well, what a difference the world could see. Wouldn't that be great? So today, Paul is talking to Timothy. And by talking to Timothy, I mean he's talking to us. And whether it's really Paul or not, since this is at the end of his life, it could have been written by one of his disciples who would say, well, if Paul were still alive, he might write these things near the end of his life. But remember, during this whole series, we've said we're not going to worry about whether Paul actually wrote these words or not. That's an awareness that we might have that someone might have written in his honor. But these words are Paul. Whether he penned them or not, they are what he would have said. And at the end of his life, in this moment, he's saying these things. He opens the chapter by summarizing the other three chapters, basically saying to Timothy, you need to keep on preaching. You need to keep on doing the work of an evangelist, of a preacher, because people have itchy ears. He uses that phrase, itchy ears. People will listen to whatever will scratch. And if they're not finding some truth, if they're not hearing something about faith, well, they'll turn to another teacher. So you've got to keep teaching them. He is encouraging of Timothy to continue to stay the course and let people know about this faith that Jesus brought into this world, this relationship that we can have with God. At the end of the chapter, he's closing out the book. And he says, well, these are some of the people that I was telling you about. They're teaching things that aren't true. They're saying things about how you're supposed to live in this world that have nothing to do with Jesus. They're defying who I am and saying no to me. Some people have just left me because of their desires for what the world offers. He's reminding Timothy that there are people who will run away from the faith. He then also says, but here are some people who are doing some great things. And he lifts them up to say thanks to them for their work and how they are models of faith in this world. But what we read today, verses 6 through 8, this is the middle of the chapter of the fourth chapter, and it's the most important part. It's what we know of this chapter. It's probably what we know of this book. Probably all the scripture that we've read over the course of this month, it's been new to you, except for this scripture, possibly. I have been poured out as a libation. I have fought the good fight. I have run the race. I have kept the faith. This is what Paul wants Timothy to do. He wants him to run those races and to fight those fights and to keep the faith. He's saying, this is what it's all been about. This is what my life has been about. Well, not completely and totally if Paul is really honest with himself. Because you remember when Jesus was up and walking and talking and breathing and healing and doing everything that Jesus did in this world, Paul didn't believe in him. It took a miracle for him to come and to understand who Jesus could be in his life. And it's from that miraculous moment that he became this great preacher and teacher of the faith. It's from that miraculous moment that he said, I'm going to go and start churches. Paul is the best and most successful church planter of anyone. Did you know that? He started churches as far away as Europe, had disciples who were starting churches. He took that message to heart. And he lived it. He's right. He kept the faith that he came to know. in that span of time from the moment he had an encounter with Jesus until his death. He preached and he taught and he encouraged. Sometimes his messages are a little unclear to us. He says to women, sit down and be quiet in church. And then he praises women for the great work they do in the church. So sometimes Paul is hard for us to understand. But in this moment, and with this beautiful poetry, these great words, we should be encouraged. One of the commentators that I read preparing for the sermon said that we should see this, these end-of-life words for Paul as if we were attending a funeral and we were listening to the eulogy, and we should take those words to heart in such a way that we remember Paul so well. But not only that, that we should take those words in so that they transform us in some way, that they make a change within us, that we want to better live as Paul would have lived, just like maybe you've been inspired by someone in your own life and you want to model your life after them. Maybe that's how we should see Paul. As one who did these great things, we should want to do these things as well. Fight those fights, run those races, and keep the faith. What does it take to keep the faith? I mean, look, difficult moments come in our lives, and sometimes we struggle to believe. Sometimes things are just fine, but we're so interested in what is happening around us that we forget our faith. What does it take? We could come up with the Sunday school answers. It takes reading the Bible and praying, and it does. It takes those things. But I also think that part of keeping the faith is keeping it real. Being who you are as a person in faith in every moment. Whether you're at church, at school, whether you're at work, in your home, being the same in all places, I think is one thing that will help people who don't come to church on an every Sunday basis, that would be something that they would like to see, because too often they think they see people who walk into the church doors as one person but walk out another. I'm not saying that's any of us in this room. But that is a perception about who church people are, isn't it? So keeping it real, being who we are in every place, I think that's part of it. I think that we have to serve the needs of our community, that we see someone in need. We have to put a hand out there to say, you're okay. There's someone who cares. Oftentimes, we would rather do deeds than speak words. But maybe part of being a faith keeper is letting people know why we do good deeds. Adam Hamilton was the last speaker at our General Assembly of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, the event that the Adams family and Ann and I went to in Columbus. And he was talking about his church, which is like 21,000 members. It's a big church. It's called the Church of the Resurrection in Kansas City. It's a United Methodist church, and he's been the minister there from its beginnings. And 20 years he's grown the church, and he shared some of the principles that helped grow his church, and some of them might be helpful, and some of them, maybe those are big church things, and our denomination has very few big churches. They had a Twitter feed that people who do Twitter and provide tweets for other people to read. Some of you, I know I'm speaking a foreign language, but a lot of the people who were watching the sermon and writing on Twitter, they didn't necessarily like some of the things that Adam was saying. They thought that he was maybe just bragging about his church a little too much. But he said some really good things about how churches need to take the faith that they have outside the doors of the church, that they have to go out into the community so that people can know of this faith. The event was sore, and he said that that birds that are too comfortable in the nest find it difficult to soar. Begs the question, are we too comfortable in our nest as a denomination? Maybe even begs the question, are we too comfortable in our nest as a local church? Might even beg the question, are we too comfortable? He also spoke about the fact that sometimes we have to use words. Remember a quote that I might have used a few months ago, that quote from St. Francis of Assisi that says, preach the gospel, which Paul told us in chapter 1, preach the gospel. St. Francis says, preach the gospel, use words if necessary. That quote can never really be attributed to St. Francis, by the way. Lots of people think that he might have said it, but there's no real, it's not written down anywhere. Anyway, that's beside the point. Adam was saying, sometimes you have to use words. Sometimes you have to let people know why it is that you're bringing them food or helping them find shelter or bringing them drink or helping them feel comfortable or just handing, being a friend to someone in need. Sometimes it's important for us as Christians to speak those words. I do this because I believe in Jesus who came to teach me something about God. And I do this because I think I'm called. We might think that's bragging, but if we don't tell people why we do what we do, how will they know? How will they know what they can do? How will they know how to be a part? How will they be able to come to know of this faith? This faith that we have, and this faith that we are the keepers of. Why is it that we have members of our church who serve on boards like at Samaritan Services and Loaves and Fishes? Why is it that we have so many people who volunteer to help raise funds for those events? Why is it we have so many people who work at these organizations and so many more? Why is it that we have people who stand and ring the bell? Is it because we like standing in the cold? It's because we have this faith that says this is how you're supposed to live. We've had some encounter with God and some understanding of Jesus that says, I want to be his disciple. I want to live in this world as he would live. I want to share a gospel message. And sometimes it's okay for people not to know why you do what you do. But sometimes it's okay if they do. Paul would encourage us to be bold. To be bold fighters fighting the fight. Be out there, open as we run our race, to let people know why we keep the faith. Fred Craddock tells a story of going to Mrs. Foster's home. I don't know who Mrs. Foster was to him. He doesn't say in the sharing of his story, but he says he went to Mrs. Foster's home because her mother was dying. And she asked if he would come and pray with her. And so he said, yes, I will come and pray with your mom. He got to Mrs. Foster's house. He walked in the door, and she handed him a Lutheran book of worship in German. And he looked at it, and he said, well, what is this? And she said, well, this is for my mother. And he said, but I thought your mother was United Methodist. And she said, she was. But when she was a teenager, that's when she came to the United States. That's when she met her husband and served in the Methodist church beside him for 41 years. But before that, she lived in Germany. And this is the faith she grew up on. She would be so pleased if you would read the Lord's Prayer to her in German. So he took the book and he read the prayer in German and he said, do you know what? She mouthed every word. Keeping the faith is not only about what others can know about faith. Keeping the faith also reminds us what we know about our faith. It gets deeply ingrained in us. It is deep-seated within us. It becomes a part of every ounce, every part of our body. Keeping the faith, is that important for God? I think it is. Is that important for others? I think it is. But ultimately, my friends, keeping the faith is important for us. For it reminds us how to fight. It reminds us how to run. It reminds us how to keep on keeping the faith. On this homecoming Sunday, may this be a message that we can hold on to. May this be a message that we can live in the name of the Christ. Amen.
Gather around the table this day. O you keepers of the faith, come to the table. O you keepers of the faith, come and find the one who is faithful to you. O keepers of the faith, be reminded this invitation is for everyone. For as Paul said, all who seek Christ are welcome. As we come to this table, may we find these good gifts. Shall we pray?
Lord, we know that you are the bread of life that has come down from heaven into this world to give us life. As we eat this bread in memory of you, we remember your body, which was given for us. We pray that we may eat in a worthy manner. Amen.
At the starting line of this day, we call on your name, God of grace. As we gaze on this cup, which reflects the image of Christ to us, we give you thanks. His sacrificial blood poured out for our sins gives us fresh strength and courage as we run the race you have set before us. When we accomplish Christian goals in our lives, may we always give you the glory. Keep us from wanting to win at others' expense or from counting ourselves better than those at our side. All who run this race are your children, and may we all cross into the next life worthy of the crown of righteousness. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
When Jesus sat at table with his disciples, he took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you." And after the meal, he took wine, and he blessed it, and he poured it. And he gave it to them, saying, "This is my blood shed for you. Each time you eat of this bread and drink from this cup, remember me." Let us remember the one we call Christ and Savior. Let us remember the one for whom we are disciples. Let us remember this love shared openly at this table for all. In the name of the Christ, let us eat and drink.
Thank you.
I like to play a game with my kids and my grandkids called the favorite game. And I simply ask them, what's your favorite food? What's your favorite class in school? What's your favorite part of the day? Or what is your favorite memory? Sometimes I can't believe the answers. In thinking about something that was my favorite childhood memory, I always think about going fossil hunting in the rain, with my father's little gray-haired secretary, Hazel Caravetta. Hazel was an avid fossil hunter and wanted to share the experience with the three of us kids. It was a great experience, climbing up the side of an abandoned coal mine with chisels and hammers and buckets. It's probably something that with today's safety standards would simply not be allowed. And you can just imagine, even though we were thrilled with our finds, how filthy, dirty we were. I think my father probably saw the look on my mother's face when we arrived home, and he promptly took us out in the backyard and hosed us down until we were clean enough to come into the house. To be truthful, I think the hosing down was a part of what made that day very special. Hazel Caravetta was a true faith keeper. Her generosity was witnessed throughout my childhood. Hazel gave us our orange cat, Sam, who lasted an almost unbelievable 23 years. Hazel brought my mother beautiful flowering African violets from her vast collection of houseplants. I remember Hazel stopping by the house after a visit from Brown County and opening the trunk of her car, which was filled with wooden baskets of peaches. I will never forget her taking a peach and splitting it in half, juice dripping all down her hand, and giving us the most wonderful peach I've ever eaten. To this day, I still try to split a peach in half like that, and it just never falls off the pit like Hazel's peach did. I often wonder at how pleased Hazel would be to know how much I thought of her and her thoughtful giving. She was truly, as Pastor Kelly noted last week, a role model for the three of us kids. So, as we think about passing the offering plate this week, let us think a little about the Hazel Caravettas in our lives and the ways we could just be a little bit like her. Let's think about giving in all kinds of ways. Could it be monetary or even more than monetary? Say something special, a favorite childhood memory that just might last a whole lifetime. Deacons.
Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to be able to give, God. Make it a constant reminder of all you have blessed us with. Amen.
We come to the point in our service where we invite anyone who wants to become a member of First Christian Church to come forward during the singing of our closing hymn. This is an opportunity for all of us to search within our soul and to see if we have found our God today, the one who is friend to us in every moment. It is an opportunity for us to begin to recommit ourselves to going into this world to keep the faith which God so freely gives to us. May all these things happen as we sing our closing hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. Please be seated for the benediction. May God grant us wisdom. May God grant us courage for the keeping of the faith. Go, my friends, as disciples of Christ, and let the world know of your faith. Sometimes use words. Amen.